This case will absolutely enrage you. A judge sent a 3-year-old back to his biological mum to be murdered. A little boy named Curtis from Ohio had been fostered since he was 7 days old. He'd been kindly taken care of by 2 lovely foster parents for 2.5 years. Now, they badly wanted to adopt Curtis and make their roles as parents official. However, they tragically never got the chance. In March 2023, a judge decided that Curtis should be sent back to his biological mum. This decision would prove to be fatal. Just months after he got sent back to Tamika Eggleton, on the 14th of June 2023, Curtis was found unresponsive in a pram in a shop. He was rushed to hospital where he sadly passed away. The autopsy confirmed that the injuries that the little boy sustained were blunt force injuries. It was determined that they could not have been done accidentally. 31-year-old Tamika was then arrested and detained on the 19th of the month. She has since pleaded guilty to murdering her biological child. Curtis absolutely had the chance to live a long and happy life with the foster parents that so desperately wanted to adopt him. Tamika is due to be sentenced in July and faces life in prison.
This woman put her toddler's head under the water because they were possessed by the Diablo. Now, of course, this happened in Daytona Beach, Florida, and Karina Mustafa is a 29-year-old behind me. She was arrested and taken in custody on suspicion of nearly killing her child via drowning. And the reason she did this is because her child knocked over some plants. That's it. So I guess she decided to fill up a bathtub and try to baptize this child. This happened on June 7th, and the father called the police after they found the child unresponsive. Now, thankfully, the father performed life-saving measures. He did CPR on the child. Then the child was transported to a hospital and is in good condition now. The father said after the toddler knocked over some plants and had some dirt on them, the mother took them to the bathroom, locked the door, and refused to let the father in. The mother is now booked and in the Volusia County Jail, but she still claims the child is out of control and possessed by the devil. I mean, why would you try to drown your child? That is just an insane reasoning there, just because they knocked over some plants. She is being charged with aggravated child abuse and cruelty towards a child. I'm sure she's going to spend some jail time. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below.
Trigger warning for anybody listening to this, but...
Have you ever seen this picture before?
No, are we focused on the mom with the kid?
This happened in 1993. The little kid's name, he's a 2-year-old. His name is James Bulger. So what happened was, there was 2 kids, Robert and John, and they had skipped school just to go shoplift, just do hooligan shit. They also, one of them admitted that they were at the mall looking for a toddler to abduct. That's when they saw James, perfect victim, right? They take him, they go to this canal, they drop him on his head, and then they drag him around, his body around, but he's not dead yet. So after that, they go to, I think, Liverpool, or around Liverpool, to other stores where the little kid, James, he's crying, he's bleeding, and it's said that there's at least 38 witnesses that witnessed him crying, but didn't say anything or didn't report anything to the police. But since nobody said anything, after they took him to a railroad, they tortured him, they killed him, they buried his head under the rubble, put his body where the train tracks are, had a train come, it sliced his fucking body in half to make it look like an accident. They ended up finding the body not too long. It was literally like half a mile away from the mall.
How old were these? They were teenagers?
Guess.
12?
They were 10 years old.
This unsettling missing persons case is happening as we speak. 21-year-old Elizabeth Green from Utah was last seen walking to work along a dirt road. She works as a rancher in a very rural area named Juab County. The area is reportedly at least 3 hours away from any major city. Elizabeth never made it to work on the 17th of April to the new job that she was attending. Unsettlingly, no one has heard from her since. She was last seen in Kaleo. She was reported missing after failing to turn up at work, and police started the hunt for her on the 18th of April. They went to the ranch that she had been heading to and searched it, but found absolutely nothing indicating where she'd gone. Now, it's very unusual for Elizabeth not to keep in contact with her family. Investigators have stated, based on the information that we have received, we are concerned about the possibility that Elizabeth is in danger of serious bodily injury or death. There's been strangely no activity on her electronic devices, and police even scoured the route that she would have had to walk to get to work that day. They haven't found her injured or lost as they initially expected. She is around 5'11" and was last seen wearing a pink tie-dye hoodie, light blue jeans, black Converse shoes, and a white backpack.
For endangering children in violation of Ohio Revised Code Section 2919.22B2. Count 4 alleges that on or about June 3rd, 2024, the defendant did knowingly cause serious physical harm.
The woman you just saw smiling and smirking in that video was 32-year-old Bianca Evans. And just earlier this month, Bianca randomly attacked a mother and her son at a supermarket, leaving the woman wounded and her son dead. Security camera footage from that day captures Bianca wandering around the shopping mart with a knife. And it's eerie because at first it looks like she's just scoping out who her target is going to be. Then towards the end of the video, she locks eyes on a mother and her son. And for some reason, people don't know exactly why this happened, she followed the mother and her son out to the parking lot and attacked them. 3-year-old Julian Wood sadly passed away after the knife attack, and his mother Margot was stabbed and wounded as well. Now, this story is already horrific enough, but it's Bianca's behavior in court that has disturbed people. In that video that I just showed you, she is literally smiling, giggling, laughing while they're reading out charges of murder that are going to be sought against her. Julian Wood's father even appeared in court and begged them to keep this monster locked up. He was very emotional in court, and it's easy to understand why. Now, what prompted this? We don't know. This is very, very disturbing stuff. And I just hope and pray that justice is served in this case. And if you want to hear more true crime stories, listen to the podcast that I co-host with my wife, Murder in America. It's available on all streaming platforms.
Let's see what you got.
What?
No way.
What the f***? The whole backstory of what just happened, right? There's a park in Veracruz, Mexico. It was called El Reino Mágico, Veracruz. And they had like characters out like Snow White.
That was Snow White?
And they had their 7 dwarves.
Oh, okay, because that's what I was saying. Are those gnomes or something?
But then mad bad stuff started happening at the park. People started dying, malfunctions in the rides and And then they closed it down. But the thing is, the reason why mad bad and mad stuff was happening, that was constructed on top of a cemetery, bro.
Oh my gosh, it's always a cemetery.
And it's said that the Snow White moves in the middle of the night, starts walking around. It's found in one spot and found in a different spot the next day. Also, the gnomes move around, and that Snow White, allegedly it's cursed.
Oh my gosh,
you
bro.
Look at her,
what the
allegedly a bad is gonna happen to you, so sorry for looking at
sorry
you
for look yo what the what
so
the fuck,
that's alleged, or you see her in person, you're supposed to ask permission before you take pictures of her.
How did you tell me that, bro?
I just remembered about it. It was also, there was this one story about a little girl, right? It's like an urban legend
related to the park
that this little girl had a birthday party, right?
This is the tree video, one of the worst ISIS execution videos you should never go looking for explained. The video that I'm about to explain is extremely brutal, and I don't recommend looking it up. The victim in the video is apparently a US spy, and he is wearing an orange jumpsuit like most victims are in ISIS videos. The video is about 40 seconds long, and it begins with the victim standing up, but his arms have been chained to 2 trees, which forces him to stand up with his arms stretched out. One of the ISIS members then reads a statement accusing the victim of being a spy. 2 young boys who look like teenagers can be seen standing behind the victim. The boys have their arms raised above their heads like they are about to swing something, and upon looking closer, you can see the 2 boys are about to swing swords. The video then shows the 2 boys swinging the swords at the same time, and they cut off the victim's outstretched arms. They manage to cut them off in one swing, but this could be due to editing because ISIS loves doing that. You then get a close-up shot of one of the older ISIS members slitting the victim's throat. The camera sits in a still shot and zooms into the victim's eyes as he is being beheaded. The video then jump cuts and it shows the victim's headless and armless corpse. It also shows the victim's severed arms hanging from the trees by the chains. The video then concludes as an even younger child who is no older than 9 reads out a statement with his foot on the victim's severed head, and this is where the video concludes. ISIS execution videos are extremely hard to watch, and I don't recommend ever looking for them, or this one. Please do yourself a favor and stay curious, because this video is extremely brutal.
A young woman was found hanged, but police suspect it was staged. Giselle Tapia Salazar was a 30-year-old mother from Texas. She was described as a charismatic and kind woman who always saw the best in everyone. She was a dedicated mother of four children. Recently, her loved ones had a horrific shock. Giselle was found deceased and hanging from a dock into the water on the 31st of May this year. This was in League City. Police confirmed that they had discovered her lifeless body dangling from a rope. On first glance, it looked like she had simply unalived herself. However, investigators decided to take a closer look. They're now stating that due to the position that her arm was found in, they believe that the scene was staged. They are suspecting she was murdered elsewhere and then placed in the position that she was found. Now, this may have been an attempt to make a homicide look like a self-unaliving. Her arm was up in a strange position and rigor mortis had set in, meaning that when she was moved to the other place, her arm remained in the stiff position that it had been originally. Her death is now being treated as foul play. The boat that she was found hanging near to was her boyfriend James Hart's boat. He spoke out after her death and stated, "This is the worst thing that has ever happened to me. It feels like a nightmare you can't wake up from. I didn't have anything to do with it and I never would have. I love Giselle more than anything in the world. We were together 24/7. I want justice for Giselle and for myself." Investigators stated that when James was told his girlfriend was deceased, he became distraught and refused to come out of his boat.
The man you just saw walking in that video was pedophile Jeffrey Doucette. Jeffrey was a 25-year-old karate instructor. Jeffrey gave karate lessons to young boys, and it's assumed that he did this to gain access to children because he was a pedophile. Now, at some point along the way, Jeffrey met the son of a man named Gary Plouchet. Gary was a very protective father who loved his son dearly. And when Gary eventually found out that Jeffrey had been molesting his son for over a year, he was righteously angry. But Gary just wasn't going to let this slide. You see, for a year, Gary had trusted Jeffrey to take care of his son and teach him karate. But at one point, Jeffrey had abducted his son, taken him to a motel in Anaheim, California, and did absolutely unspeakable things to him. So that leads us to the infamous televised incident. On that day, Jeffrey was flown to Louisiana to face trial. There was a news team there waiting for him at the airport for when he arrived into the state, but there was somebody else waiting for Jeffrey there as well, Gary Plouchet. I can't show you the full clip, obviously, but Gary was waiting for Jeffrey to walk down that hallway, and when he walked by him, he pulled out a handgun and shot Jeffrey, the man who molested his son, directly in the head. Afterwards, Gary gave himself up, dropped the gun, and he was initially charged with second-degree murder. But he entered a plea bargain and pled no contest to the manslaughter charges. He was then sentenced to 7 years of a suspended sentence, with 5 years of probation and 300 hours of community service. Meaning that Gary spent no extended time in prison for the murder of the pedophile. To this day, people still sell merchandise with Gary Plouchet all over it, as he has become a folk hero of sorts to people that hate pedophiles. If you want to hear more stories like this, listen to the podcast Murder in America that I co-host with my wife Courtney. It's available to listen to now on all streaming platforms.
A parole officer never returned to work after doing a routine check. What had happened to him was the last thing anyone expected. 54-year-old convicted S offender Emmanuel Edward Sewell lived in Maryland. Now, he had a dark criminal past and had spent many years in prison for R. Back in 1996, on Halloween, he'd broken into a man's house through the downstairs open window. He threatened him at knife point, then tied him up, and then SA'd him. He then stole the man's bank card, his video recorder, and also his car. Now, he was on probation and was having regular checks from parole officers. On the 31st of May 2023, parole officer Davis Martinez was due to go and check on Emmanuel. When his colleagues never heard back from him that day, they got increasingly concerned. It shouldn't have been taking him as long as it was. They decided to send over some backup and just see what was going on. They had absolutely no idea of the horrors they would find. Police showed up to Emmanuel's apartment in Chevy Chase to see all of the blinds and curtains closed. They called out and no one appeared to be home. But they knew that this is where their colleague had been. They decided to force entry into the home, and what they found behind the door would traumatize them. Their colleague was dead in the fetal position underneath the bed. He was wrapped in plastic and nearby was a bloody towel. He'd been stabbed in the head, neck, and face. Now, investigators started interviewing neighbors to put a timeline together of what had gone on here. One neighbor reported hearing knocking at Emmanuel's door at about 9 a.m. The neighbor reported then at a later stage seeing Emmanuel leave the property and quickly return. He was also allegedly spotted driving off in his car with clear bin bags full of clothing. Emmanuel has been arrested and has been charged with second-degree murder.
This is by far the worst war crime caught on camera, and whatever you do, don't look up the video. This video made its way online on July 28th, 2022, and the video shows the torture of a Ukrainian soldier who was captured by Russian soldiers during the ongoing war. And before I begin, this is your warning. Never go searching for this clip. The video is 1 minute and 33 seconds long, and the video was recorded in the day. And as you play the video, you see the captive who is on the ground, and he is surrounded by several men. His hands are tied behind his back, and his mouth has been gagged. His captors then turn him over so he's lying on his stomach, and one even stomps on him, which makes the victim grimace in pain through his gag. After the victim has been turned over, you see the back of his combat pants have been cut, exposing his thighs and butt. A man with a hat on can be seen kneeling over the victim, and he's holding what appears to be a box cutter or a surgical blade. He's also wearing blue surgical gloves, the gloves you'll see a doctor wearing in a hospital. The victim's legs also have rope tied around them, and it appears two men are holding the rope off camera to stretch apart the victim's legs. The torturer then cuts the victim's underwear, which exposes his genitals. The killer then kneels down again and begins to slice from the back of the man's scrotum. I could only imagine the pain he went through. After a short while of cutting, the man's testicles are exposed due to his scrotum being cut. The killer then stops cutting for a while and walks out of shot for a few seconds. The victim then continues to make awful sounds as he lies on the ground in complete utter pain. The killer with the blade then enters the shot again, but this time he has taken off one of his surgical gloves and for whatever reason replaced it with a plastic bag covering his hand. The killer then continues slicing again and using the hand in the plastic bag to grab the victim's testicles and pull as he is slicing. The victim continues to make awful noises as every slice draws a reaction from his body. Near the end of the castration, the killer is pulling the victim's privates and it looks like he cuts off his scrotum and testicles, though it's hard to tell due to the camera quality and the bloody nature of the video. Eventually, the victim is castrated and the killer holds the victim's manhood up to the camera and then drops it on the ground next to him. And finally, the awful video then concludes. There is a longer version of this video out there, and according to numerous sources, it shows the torturer is placing the victim's testicles next to his head before shooting him dead, followed by them throwing his body into a ditch. This is by far one of the worst videos I covered, as well as one of the worst war crimes caught on camera. I feel so bad for this man, and some humans are just truly evil. Whatever you do, never go searching for this video, trust me.
This case will put you off ever going bowling again. Richard Card was a 40-year-old man from Bowdoin, Maine. He was an ex-army reserve and had an 18-year-old son with his ex-wife. Now, his ex-wife had actually reported him to police for concerns over his welfare. She said that after he had been given hearing aids, he'd started hallucinating. He'd become very paranoid about what people thought of him. Now, his ex-wife wasn't the only person who'd actually reported him to police. His army unit also expressed concerns about his mental state. This was after he had commented to them that he would shoot up the base. He had a very short temper and started displaying erratic behaviour. Everyone had suspicions that one day he might do something horrific. Now, he actually ended up being admitted to a psychiatric facility and received treatment there for 2 weeks before he was discharged. He was prescribed medication, but unfortunately didn't continue to take it. On the 25th of October 2023, at around 6:56 p.m., Robert entered the just-in-time Lewiston Bowling Alley. Now, I've positioned myself here intentionally so that the video doesn't get taken down for what is behind my head. A youth event was taking place at the alley, which made the place quite busy. Chillingly, on the door of the bowling alley, it states, "Choose your weapon." Robert was armed with a semi-automatic rifle and began to fire at innocent members of the public. Plainclothes police officers did actually happen to be nearby, and people started ringing the police as well. Within 4 minutes of Robert beginning to shoot, officers arrived at the scene. Robert had prowled through the alley, systematically shooting at people, and he killed 7 people there. But he was not done yet. He then made his way 4 miles to a bar and grill. At 7:08 p.m, another call came into the police station to report a second shooting. Inside the restaurant again, Robert began systematically shooting at innocent members of the public. He killed 7 people inside and 1 person outside of the restaurant. Three people were also injured during this shooting and were taken to hospital and then subsequently passed away from their injuries. The danger was still not over though. Robert fled and abandoned his Subaru. Locals were alerted to an active shooter and people were advised to stay indoors. Shops and other businesses closed. Every single police officer in the area began to help in the anxious hunt for Robert. It would be 2 days before any news. On the 27th of October, the locals breathed a sigh of relief. Robert had been found dead from a self-inflicted gunshot wound. He was actually found at a recycling centre, which is believed to have been nearby to his previous place of work. The autopsy stated that he died between 8 to 12 hours before he was actually found. 18 innocent lives were taken in the tragedy. They were all between the ages of 14 and 76.
This is the last known footage of 4-year-old Cash Gernon, who was kidnapped out of a bed that he shared with his twin brother. He would later be found stabbed to death just 8 blocks away. In the early morning hours of May 15th, 2021, footage from a baby monitor shows 18-year-old Darren Brown enter a bedroom shared by 4-year-old twins Cash and Carter. The twins had been staying with a woman named Monica in Dallas, Texas for several months after their dad Trevor reportedly left them there to look for work out of town. Trevor said that he didn't want to disturb their schedule, so he left them with Monica, but after he left, he never contacted Monica again. And to make matters worse, the twins' mom had no idea where they were. The baby monitor showed Darren kidnap Cash from his bed, and the moments that follow are horrific. Darren carried Cash, still sleeping, 8 blocks away to a walking trail and proceeded to stab him several times in the chest, killing him. He then brought Cash's body back out to a public street and left him there. His body would be found a few hours later by a woman out on a morning walk, and she said she's never seen anything more horrifying. Cash was just laying there in a pool of blood, and ants were covering the bottoms of his feet. She called 911 and stayed with him until the police arrived, but it was clear he was already gone. Monica slept in that morning, and around 3 hours later, when she realized Cash was gone, she reported him missing to the police. After reviewing the baby monitor footage, Monica said she knew who the suspect was and that Darren lived in the neighborhood and would play with her kids. What's terrifying is that the footage shows Darren coming back 2 hours after kidnapping Cash and hovering over Carter, who was still asleep in his bed, but he abruptly left. At this point, Cash was already dead. Darren was arrested 1 day later and charged with burglary, kidnapping, and capital murder after Cash's blood was found on his clothing. It's not clear how Darren got into the home or what his motive was, although nothing could justify what was done to little Cash. Darren was reportedly at the home 2 days before the murder. At the time, he already had a misdemeanor and was out of jail on bond. Because of how publicized this case was, Monica's neighbor decided to go through his security footage and found that 2 months before Cash's murder, Darren was creeping around his house. He shares a back alley with Monica, and the video shows Darren opening up the gate to his yard, looking around, and then leaving. That neighbor has kids, so I can't imagine how terrifying that was to see. In 2022, Darren was found incompetent to stand trial after he was mentally evaluated by a psychologist and a psychiatrist. A third medical expert also deemed him unfit to stand trial. His attorney stated that he was in a trance-like state at the time of the murder and suffers from hallucinations due to being schizophrenic. So instead of jail time, he was transferred to Vernon Psychiatric Hospital. Since the murder, Cash's dad Trevor has released a statement on YouTube basically explaining why he left the boys with Monica. He said he knew Monica for years and went to go look for work out of town and just didn't want to bother the boys. But like I said earlier, he never once contacted Monica after he left. He never mentioned the boys' mom and didn't clarify why he never left the boys with family instead, as their mom's family had been looking for them for several months. Cash was let down by so many people. This is a story that will never leave my mind, especially as a parent.
This girl was brutally murdered after she got into the wrong Uber. 21-year-old Samantha Josephson had ordered an Uber and mistakenly entered a car that she thought was her Uber. Nathaniel Rowland, the driver of the car, used childproof locks to prevent Samantha from leaving the vehicle and then kidnapped and murdered her, leaving her body 65 miles away. Samantha was an amazing girl and she went to the University of South Carolina and was in a sorority. She had big plans for her life until Nathaniel decided he wanted to commit a disturbing act. The night of her murder, Samantha was planning on spending the night at her friend's and they were at a bar. And around 2 a.m., she decided to leave and call an Uber. A black Chevrolet Impala driven by Nathaniel pulled up beside her and Samantha entered the vehicle, thinking it was her Uber driver. And according to authorities, Nathaniel activated the child lock so that the doors could only be opened from the outside, thereby trapping Samantha completely inside the vehicle. And using a two-bladed knife, Nathaniel proceeded to inflict 120 stab wounds upon Samantha. During the attack, Samantha attempted to shoot herself, and one of Nathaniel's strikes went completely through her right hand, as she likely used it to protect herself from one of the knife strikes. Nathaniel also stabbed Samantha in her head with enough force that the knife went through her skull to her brain. He also stabbed her in the carotid, which is one of the two main arteries that carries blood to the head. Many of the wounds, especially those in her right neck and right shoulder, were close together, most likely resulting from being rapidly inflicted stab wounds. Additionally, Samantha suffered a severed hyoid bone, as well as stab wounds to her neck, face, shoulder, torso, back, lungs, legs, and feet. She bled profusely, ultimately dying within 10 to 20 minutes. And on July 27, 2021, after just 1 hour of deliberation, a jury found Nathaniel Rowland guilty of kidnapping and murdering Samantha Josephson. Now, what I'm about to show you is Nathaniel reacting to his sentencing of life in prison.
She was an amazing person, an amazing human being. And the testimony is here. And she obviously put up an amazing fight against you and left a sufficient trail for the jury to see. Your whole 24 hours, minute by minute, mile by mile, digit by digit, that's led you here, and you've now been found guilty. And sentencing in this case is not difficult. The sentence in this case is easy. The sentence of the court for is that you be committed to the State Department of Corrections for life. Any other sentence that can be imposed will be concurrent with life. Since you only have one life, that sentence must be served for the remaining days of your natural life. That's the sentence of the court. If you remove Mr. from the courtroom, Mr. Rowland.
Bet you've never heard of the female Peterborough serial killer. Joanna Denny was born in St. Albans, Hertfordshire. When she was just 16, she ran away from home with her older boyfriend. He was 21-year-old John Trina. Now, Joanna would regularly take substances and drink heavily. This became an issue when she got pregnant the following year. She gave birth to a daughter, but it didn't change her partying ways. She then got pregnant again in 2005, and when she gave birth, John decided to leave her and take the children. She was unwilling to care for them, and her lifestyle made it really unsafe for children. She was also regularly cheating on him as well. She actually decided to move to Peterborough and met a new man called Gary Richards. The pair were friends, but it's believed that Gary had feelings for her. She was regularly engaging in S-work to fund her lifestyle and ensure that she could still buy those substances. By this point, Joanna was 29 years old. In February 2012, she was arrested for theft. This was actually the catalyst to a number of very serious events. She was hospitalized temporarily in a psychiatric facility. She received a diagnosis of OCD and antisocial disorder. No one had any idea of just how bad things were about to get. At some point between the 19th of March and the 29th of March 2013, Joanna met 31-year-old Lucas Slabowski. They were both into a similar lifestyle of drinking substances. Joanna took Lucas to another property and blindfolded him. She then stabbed him through the heart. She kept his body in a bin for days before taking her next victim. This was 56-year-old John Chapman. He was actually one of her flatmates. She also stabbed him, killing him as well. But she didn't stop there, and a matter of hours later, she met up with her landlord. This was 48-year-old Kevin Lee. The pair had been having a sexual relationship, and she made him put a black dress on, covered in sequins, and then she stabbed him to death too. Joanna's friend Gary actually helped her to dispose of the victims' bodies. This was along with another man, Leslie Layton. The trio dumped the remains in various ditches around Peterborough. After disposing of the bodies, the three of them then drove to Hereford. There, they bumped into two unfortunate men. John Rogers and Robin Bereza were out walking their dogs. They were ambushed by Joanna, who was carrying a knife. Now, Joanna had previously told her two male friends that she wanted to have some fun. She stabbed both of the men in a callous attack. Thankfully, both men got speedy medical attention and survived. They would later be key to her conviction. Meanwhile, days after his death, Kevin's family reported him missing to police. A search began and he was found in a ditch. Now, Joanna had gone on the run, but thankfully police managed to track her down and arrest her. She was captured on CCTV in the police station, laughing and flirting with the officers. She was eventually sentenced to life in prison and is only the third woman in the UK to be sentenced to a whole life tariff. This places her alongside infamous killers Myra Hindley and Rose West. Her motive for the killings appears to be just that she felt it was good entertainment. As for her accomplices, the men that helped Joanna told police that they did so out of fear. They didn't want to be the next victims. Gary was given life in prison with a minimum of 19 years, and Leslie got 14.
No one has ever been convicted for the murders of these four children. These are the victims of the Oakland County child killer. It all started when Mark Douglas Stebbins went missing after walking home from an event with his family. His body was found 4 days later, he had been assaulted, and he had been held in captivity. Over the next coming months, three additional children would be abducted and murdered in a similar fashion, and people at the time thought that this was all the work of one man. They had suspect sketches, they claimed that he was driving a blue AMC Gremlin, and yet, after years of searching, the trail went cold and no one was ever arrested for these murders. Well, that's because I think this entire time they were looking in the wrong direction. The Oakland County child killer was not one man. In fact, as it's been proven in court documents, it was a ring of pedophiles that were abducting these children, abusing them, possibly producing snuff films of them being killed, and then dumping them. The lead suspect that everyone talks about is Chris Bush. Now, Christopher was the son of a wealthy General Motors executive. Christopher had recently been arrested and charged with assaulting a child, multiple children, and when the police interviewed him, Christopher's friend confessed that Chris had a part in the murders. Chris confessed that his friend had a part in the murders. The police also had DNA evidence that may have matched him. We still don't know who it matches. But the public found out decades later that Chris also failed a polygraph exam. So this guy was looking like he was the guy. But then suddenly, in the middle of the investigation, Chris Bush takes his own life. Now, there are a lot of things that don't make sense here. There were multiple shell casings there. There was no blood at the scene. Christopher's body was wrapped tightly in a sheet. The front and back doors to his house were open. And there were some suspicious items that were found in Christopher's room. This included some ligatures, aka ropes. And the victims of the Oakland County child killer had evidence of rope burns on them, meaning that they had been bound during their captivity. There was also this picture on Christopher's wall, which a lot of people claim looks like a screaming Mark Stebbins. I mean, it's really eerie, it's hand-drawn, but I've talked to researchers in this case, and they all agree that Christopher was not a very good artist. This was a known fact amongst his personal circle. In my opinion, someone drew that picture, hung it up on the wall up there, they dumped the ropes there, and Christopher was killed to protect the rest of this ring. Now, Christopher wasn't innocent by any means. But by doing this, by killing Christopher, they did manage to put a cap on the story. And to this day, these murders remain unsolved. Oh yeah, and Christopher Bush is still not officially a suspect. I mean, just one look at this picture and it's just, ugh. Something else bizarre is that they found a box of CP inside of Christopher's room. 8mm film reels and photographs. Nobody knows what happened to that evidence. It disappeared. And in addition, nobody ever watched through the 8mm film. I don't know why they didn't, but they didn't. And this is bizarre because it's alleged by victims' family members, investigators, private investigators, that these kids were killed on film as a part of a snuff film ring. You see, Christopher Bush was tied into the North Fox Island pedophile ring. This was a pedophile ring being run off of this island in Lake Michigan. And a lot of the suspects that are involved in the Oakland County child killings visited the island. They were linked to the island through paperwork. And yeah, that's a whole nother rabbit hole we could go down. But I really wanted justice for these four children, so we set out to investigate all of this on the ground in Michigan. And I just released my documentary where we interviewed an author of a book. I spoke to victims' family members. And this is truly one of the most bizarre rabbit holes you can possibly go down. Because the Oakland County child killer wasn't one man. It was a group of people that got away with it. If you want to watch the video, it is on YouTube now, and this is my channel in case you need to know where to go.
Hammer coined the phrase, "You can't make this stuff up," might have known the story of real-life boogeyman Albert Fish. A slight, elderly man with grey hair, no one suspected the kindly single father of being sadistic child murderer and cannibal.
This man murdered his girlfriend and then died of a heart attack while he was burying her. In May 2022, locals rang police after they noticed a man unresponsive in his garden. Police in South Carolina raced to the scene and they found the body of 60-year-old Joseph McKinnon. He was found lying next to a big hole in the ground that he'd been digging.
It also became apparent that his girlfriend Patricia was missing. Now, police tried and failed to get a hold of her and then eventually found blood in the pair's home. When they questioned her work colleagues, it turned out that she hadn't turned up to work that day, and that was extremely unusual. When police did some further digging into the case, they discovered that actually the hole that Joseph was digging was a grave for Patricia. Joseph had attacked her and then wrapped her body up in bin bags. After killing her, he'd had a heart attack while trying to conceal her body.
Nothing could have prepared me for the end of this story. So when I was little, I used to always complain about a scratching noise coming from the room next to me. My dad actually converted the guest bedroom next to my room into a home office, and I was never allowed in there. He was a really busy man. One night, I was laying in bed, unable to sleep, when I thought I heard a small sob come from his office. I could faintly make out the sound of a woman crying, but I knew I wasn't allowed to go in there. And honestly, at that point, I was kind of too afraid to anyways. The next day, I told my dad what I had heard, and he told me it was probably just a bad dream. But that didn't make any sense to me because I knew what I had heard. My dad spent the entire day in his office that day. I didn't see him come out once. The next night, I waited until my father was asleep, and I did what I knew I shouldn't do. I went into his office. And when I opened the door, there were no books. There was no desk. There wasn't even a single chair. Just scratched into the walls a million times. Help me.
These are three California creatures you never heard about.
Up first is the Dark Watchers, and they're usually sighted in the mountains of California, and are described as tall, featureless, dark silhouettes, often wearing brimmed hats and having walking sticks. If you ever see a Dark Watcher, whatever you do, never approach it, because if you do, you will completely vanish forever. Next is Tahoe Tessie, who is a water creature and is living in Lake Tahoe. It's been described as having smooth skin, and is apparently so big it's the size of a bus. So next time you go to Lake Tahoe, you better look around for Tahoe Tessie. Finally is the Lone Pine Devil. This is also a creature who is often sighted in the mountains of California, and it's described as a large creature with both bird and reptile qualities. They have razor-sharp claws and venomous fangs. So what creature do you think the creepiest is? In my opinion, it has to be the Dark Watchers just because of how creepy and weird they sound. But either way, let me know which one is the scariest to you.
Whatever you do, do not look into her eyes.
My father locked me in our basement for 11 days and claimed not to know I was there. My name is Charles Bothwell V. I was 12 years old in 2014 when my father, Charles Bothwell IV, still had custody of me and mistreated me. In June 2014, my father reported me missing. The police conducted an intensive search, but eventually, I was found hidden in the basement of the family home, approximately 11 days after being reported missing. I lived in inhumane conditions. My parents deprived me of food, subjected me to repeated abuse and violence, and cut me off from all social contact. My father even pleaded for public assistance on television during my supposed disappearance, while he himself was the perpetrator. The case took a shocking turn when investigators discovered that my father was aware of my presence in the basement. Both my father and mother were arrested and charged with severe parental neglect. Investigators also found evidence of abuse against me. I was subsequently placed under the custody of Child Protective Services. My father was then sentenced to 18 months probation and ordered to take anger classes, and he will no longer be allowed to approach or contact me.
I threw my baby from the fourth floor. My name is Sonia Hermosillo, and I was 42 years old in 2011 when I committed the worst act. I had three children, including two little girls, and my baby, Noah Medina, a 7-month-old boy with autism. My husband and my daughter had already noticed that since the birth of my son, Noah, I had a different behavior. His illness and various health problems, such as the flat head that required him to wear a helmet all the time, had particularly affected me, and I often neglected the way I took care of him. That's why my husband decided not to leave me alone with our baby, but I took advantage of the fact that he was in the shower to take him and leave with him. That day, he was supposed to undergo tests at the hospital, so I drove there. And once I arrived, I parked on the fourth floor of the parking lot. Once out of the car, I thought that throwing him from the top of the four floors might be a good idea to see if he could survive. So I took him, removed the helmet he was supposed to wear, and threw him, and he died instantly. I was quickly arrested by the police. Once arrested, I said that all of this was due to mental problems. I confessed to the police that I killed him because of the problems he had. I was then sentenced to 25 years in prison without parole.
This is the time I was almost abducted by a serial killer. In February of 2012, I went to go visit my grandfather's grave for his birthday. His death was a pretty hard thing for me to process, as he only died in March of 2011, so it was all still pretty new to me. I was kneeling in front of his grave, crying and thinking to myself, when all of a sudden I looked up and see a man running at me full speed from the woods in front of me. I was able to get myself to my truck pretty quickly before he got to me, but by the time I got in the truck, he was only about 50 feet away. I got in my car before he could get to me and locked the doors, much to his displeasure. He like threw his hands up as if he had lost a football game. I started my truck and started driving out as fast as I could, but not before I passed him. I didn't break eye contact with him the entire time I was driving past, so I got a really good look at him. So cut to a few years later, I'm pretty bored at work, so I download this random app that has a bunch of paranormal, UFO, cryptid, and serial killer stories on it. And as I'm browsing through stories, I come across one that makes my heart absolutely drop. There was a photo of a man I recognized very well, Israel Keyes, who was most known for murdering an underage girl in Alaska, dismembering her, and throwing the pieces of her body in a lake. He would bury kill kits in places long before he ever committed the crimes. He had been killing for a few years to the point where no one really knew what his actual death toll was. And he would eventually go on to take his own life in prison. At the end of this book I read about him, they mentioned his favorite places to abduct people. Public parks and cemeteries. I often wonder if he left any kill kits in that cemetery. You were fast, Israel, but I was faster.
This abandoned prison is straight out of a nightmare. Welcome to the Mid-Orange Correctional Facility in Warwick, New York. Originally opened as a reform school for boys, this sprawling complex was eventually turned into a prison for men. And over the years, it housed a number of deplorable criminals from New York State, including an infamous serial killer. As you walk the halls of this crumbling complex, you can feel the energy. You can feel the souls reaching out to try to talk to you. One of the more infamous spirits that haunts this property is that of a teenager named Jimmy. Obviously, back when this was a reform school for boys, abuse was rampant in these halls. And one teenager named Jimmy decided to take his own life by hanging himself in one of the buildings out back. Now, I can tell you from firsthand experience that this place is definitely haunted. I spent the night there ghost hunting while filming an episode of my show with the New York Post, which is available on YouTube now, and you could just feel the energy of these buildings emanating. I mean, there were a number of crazy historical things that happened here in these buildings, including a riot, and obviously tons of people lost their lives here over the years. I mean, the Mid-Orange Correctional Facility was known as one of the most violent prisons in the state of New York. And every single part of this complex is haunted, including this eerie church that was left abandoned after the building was closed. When this building sat empty for years, rituals were performed by people that broke in here. And the dark energy from these rituals still remains. If you want to see the full video that I filmed here, just head to the New York Post's YouTube channel. And for more spooky content, follow me on YouTube at The Paranormal Files.
This baby was kidnapped and then the parents received the wrong baby back. In April 1964, Dora Fronczak gave birth to baby Paul. Although this should have been one of the happiest days of her life, it soon escalated into a nightmare. Paul was kidnapped. A woman posed as a nurse and using her fake profession, she managed to steal Paul from the Chicago hospital. Word spread that the baby was missing and 600 homes were frantically searched. Paul's parents made devastating pleas for his return. Now, police only had Paul's ear shape and blood type to go off. However, they did soon find an abandoned child in New Jersey. When Dora saw him, she was incredibly relieved. She had baby Paul back, and that would be the last of it for 10 years. One Christmas, when he was hunting for presents, 10-year-old Paul discovered a memory box, and inside this box were news clippings from his kidnapping. When he confronted his mum about this, she shut the conversation down, but it stayed in the back of his mind. Paul started to have doubts about his true history. In 2012, he did a DNA test and the results shocked everyone. Paul was not the Paul who'd been kidnapped. He wasn't biologically related to either of his parents. Now, sadly, his parents were actually furious at Paul and they refused to speak to him for a year. In 2015, Paul discovered that he was actually born as Jack and he had a twin sister, Jill. His biological mum had a drinking problem and his dad was a violent man. Meanwhile, the FBI ended up reopening the case of missing baby Paul. It was actually another home DNA test that revealed where he was. A man named Kevin Beatty was actually missing baby Paul. Now, the woman who raised him had actually passed away, so some mystery still remains about missing baby Paul. Tragically, in 2019, Dora actually arranged to meet her long-lost son, Kevin. However, before the pair could reunite, Kevin actually died of cancer. Paul's twin sister Jill is still missing. He continues to look for her and you could actually help solve this cold case. By taking home DNA tests and uploading your information onto GEDmatch.com, we can all help to solve cold cases.
This is the backpacking beheadings, the tragic case of Louise Jesperson and Marie Newland.
Before Louise Jesperson and Marie Newland embarked on their journey to Morocco, Louise posted on Facebook letting her friends know she would be making a trip to Morocco and was asking anyone out there if they knew about Mount Tubkul, and the theory is this post put the attackers on high alert, and apparently how the girls would become targets of the attackers. Nobody knows how true this is, but it's the leading theory. But the girls continued on their journey, and eventually as night fell, they set up camp to rest. During their hike, it's believed the attackers were stalking their victims, waiting for them to stop, waiting for them to get further away from civilization, and once this happened, the attacks ensued. The attack was brutal, and both Louise and Marine were brutally beheaded, and some reports even claim the girls were sexually assaulted. The murder of Louise Jesperson was recorded and posted online. It's believed Marine Newland was murdered first, but there's no video of that, though people online claim it's out there. The video starts with Louise Jesperson lying on her stomach, and she's wearing a t-shirt and underwear. And almost immediately, the terrorist attempts to behead her. But he starts from the back of the neck, and that usually isn't the way to do it. Right when he cuts, Louise says ow and begins to scream, and apparently in her native language she was begging for her mother. Once the man beheading her realizes it's hard to behead someone from behind, he then turns her over and one of the people he was with stomps on her face to hold her down, and he then starts beheading her from the neck. And at this point, there's a lot of blood and a lot of screaming and gurgling. He then begins hacking at her neck to complete the beheading, and once he's beheaded Louise Jesperson, he picks up her head and takes it to her tent and places it inside, and the video concludes. It's a quick video, but it's extremely bloody, extremely horrible, and extremely sad. It's definitely one of the worst beheadings I ever covered, mainly because these girls were very young, very naive, and didn't deserve what happened to them at all. One of the girls even posted how the world is safe and that we shouldn't judge people, and it's super sad that they paid the price of this with their life. Please don't go looking for this video because it will stick with you forever and it's really not worth it. Rest in peace to Louise Jesperson and Marie Newland.
This is one of the most dangerous men in Canadian history, Shane Pattinson. And while he doesn't really look it on the outside, he really is a dangerous and twisted man. So in 2012, Shane was sentenced to 5 years in prison because he had collected over 4,500 CP images depicting the extreme SA of young girls under the age of five. 4,500 images. So he served most of his prison sentence and he was released in 2015 and was immediately sent to a halfway house with the Salvation Army. But just shortly after getting out of prison, when he went to the halfway house, investigators performed a routine check-in on him, and what they found was extremely shocking. When investigators checked in on Shane, they walked into the room, they found him naked from the waist down, he had three devices open, each of them displaying CP images, and he was actively toying with himself at the time that they walked in to these images. When these investigators performed searches on what Shane had in his room, they discovered that in the short time he was out from prison, he had already accrued thousands of additional CP images and was actively sharing them with other users across the internet. This means that he served his first sentence for CP possession. He got out and almost immediately went back to collecting it and obsessing over it. And like I said before, this guy had thousands of victims across the planet, and he was working his way into the dark web to connect with other pedophiles across the world. Now, Shane has a pretty disturbing life story. When he was only 3 years old, he allegedly played mommy and daddy with a 4-year-old cousin of his, a game which turned graphic, if you know what I mean. He then stated that his great-grandfather sexually abused him for years until he hit puberty. And he said that he first started viewing CP images when he was only 14 years old. He also stated that when he was just 14 years old, he SA'd an 8-year-old friend of his sister's. He also told interviewers that he was intensely aroused by smelling women's undergarments and by sniffing dirty, soiled diapers. So he was eventually sentenced to 7 years in prison, but with his time served, he was actually only given 5.5 years, and this happened back in 2018, which means, if it all worked out in his favor, this year, Shane Pattison will be released from prison. And after reading this dude's story and learning about what he does, I do not think that he's going to be able to live in a normal society. I don't know how or why he's being released so quickly, but I'm just really afraid for what's going to happen when he's out next.
This is the 10 days of horror that shocked Pennsylvania. On the 5th of July 2017, Jimmy Patrick left his house. He was a student living with his grandparents, and he was going to Cosmo DiNardo's house to buy marijuana. Cosmo had a history of schizophrenia and had been sectioned the year prior. He was known to police and had been arrested for possessing a gun. Now, this was illegal due to his mental health issues. Jimmy got to Cosmo's house, which was in a remote location. As he got out of the car, Cosmo shot him. He then dug a hole and buried him. The following day, when Jimmy never came home, his granddad reported him missing. Meanwhile, Cosmo was planning other drug deals. He agreed to meet with another student, 19-year-old Dean Finocchiero. Before picking up Dean, he picked up his cousin, Sean Kratz. Now, Sean was also known to police, and he had many arrests due to theft and robbery. The pair decided to rob Dean instead of selling him substances. Again, Dean was shot and killed at the farmland. They wrapped him in tarp and put him in a metal tank. The same day, Cosmo met Thomas Mio and Mark Sturgis while his cousin stayed at the property. When they got back, Cosmo shot Thomas as he got out of the truck and he fell to the ground. Mark tried to sprint away, but Cosmo shot him and killed him. Cosmo then ran over Thomas with his truck, crushing him to death. He put the two bodies in the metal tank and poured petrol over them and set them alight. That evening and the following day, more of the parents reported their sons missing. Cosmo then contacted somebody in order to sell them Thomas's car. Meanwhile, however, police were tracking the cars of the missing boys. They found Thomas's car at Cosmo's family home. Cosmo was questioned but lied his way out of this. On day 6 of the investigation, police tracked one of the missing boys' phones to Cosmo's family home. Cosmo was arrested on firearms charges and his bail was set to $1 million. His dad actually paid 10% of this in cash and Cosmo was free. Police then managed to rearrest Cosmo because of the fact that he tried to sell a missing boy's car. Shortly after, police discovered the bodies of 3 of the boys on the property. Cosmo confessed to police and then told them where to find Jimmy's body. He got 4 consecutive life sentences and his cousin, Sean, got life in prison plus 18 to 36 years.
On March 17th in Pensacola, Florida, bridge worker Mason Ponder came across an unusually heavy suitcase. He had no idea that it contained the body of Gannon. Here's his testimony in court.
I was the first one to unzip it. And before we opened it, as soon as we unzipped it, we immediately noticed the smell. That's what hit us first. I remember looking up at Matt, who's quite a bit taller than me. And I said, Matt, I think there's something dead in here. And unfortunately, we do come across, sometimes somebody will throw out a litter of puppies or something in a bag. And, you know, that's not uncommon. And it smelled, but it was so strong. It was different that day. So I didn't initially open it, and we kind of thought about what we were going to do first. When we finally went ahead and unzipped the rest of it, the smell was so overpowering, we kind of took a step back. And the first thing I remember seeing was just two little feet, and that had little football socks on them. The best I remember, that's I remember to being little socks on them. And before I could, before anything else happened, I couldn't really make out what it was. Matt dumped the suitcase over, and of course we initially immediately knew it was a body. But after looking at it, it was we couldn't tell male or female, boy or girl. We didn't know. A lot of black hair.
Gannon's autopsy revealed blunt force trauma to the head, a gunshot wound to his jaw, and 12 separate stab wounds. This 11-year-old boy had suffered horrifically at the hands of his evil stepmother. Letitia was charged with the murder of Gannon and faces a total of 13 charges, including first-degree murder, child abuse causing death, and tampering with evidence. In 2022, Letitia changed her plea from guilty to not guilty by reason of insanity, stating that she was insane at the time of Gannon's murder. This delayed the start of a trial because she had to be evaluated multiple times to determine the state of her mental health. In March 2023, the jury was selected, and Letitia's defence claimed that the latest sanity report showed her to be insane at the time of Gannon's murder, claiming that she suffered a major psychotic crack at the time of the brutal killing. The state, however, have argued that the fact she tried to cover the crime up so well and throw off the police shows that she knew right from wrong. The trial continues and you can follow it live over on Law and Crime. Pure evil or mentally ill? In 2012, when Zachary Davis was just 15 years old, he entered his mother's bedroom in the dead of night and struck her over the head 20 times with a sledgehammer.
Did you kill your mother?
Yeah.
And why did you kill her?
She wasn't taking care of my family.
And where did you hit her?
In the head.
Where was she when you did this?
She was asleep.
You've got a sledgehammer in one hand, and you open that door, what's going through your head at that moment?
My mind was pretty much blank. I could just hear the hammer hitting her head.
And what did it sound like?
There was this wet thumping sound.
Zachary was a very quiet child. He lived with his parents and his older brother Josh, but when he was just 9 years old, his dad died from Lou Gehrig's disease, and it sent Zachary into a downward spiral. He was seen by a psychiatrist and diagnosed with schizophrenia and depressive disorder, and he started therapy. During therapy, Zachary went through the first two phases common in the bereavement process, numbness and depression, but he never made it to the third, recovery. His mother Melanie pulled him out of therapy after just 4 sessions and moved the family to Tennessee, thinking that they were starting a new life. Melanie worked as a paralegal and tried her best to provide a life for her 2 boys, but Zachary was becoming more and more withdrawn. By the time Zachary was 15, he was a complete outcast at school. He often spoke in whispers and wore the same hoodie every day, pulled up around his face. He had an app on his phone about serial killers and another that listed torture devices. Zachary showed absolutely no signs of violence outwardly, but beneath the surface, something awful was bubbling. August 10th, 2012 was like any other day. Zachary, his brother and his mum went to watch a movie, and then when they got home, Melanie went up to bed. Once Zachary was sure that his mum was asleep and after his brother had also gone to bed, he grabbed a sledgehammer from the basement, went into his mother's room and started hitting her over the head, again and again, 20 times in total. Melanie actually woke up after the first blow and started gasping for air. She then started to experience seizures while her son hit her over the head again and again until he was sure she was dead. He then went to the family's game room where he doused it in petrol and whiskey and set it on fire, intending to kill his brother Josh. The only problem was that he'd shut the door to the game room and the fire didn't spread as quickly as he'd hoped. Josh escaped and went to a neighbour's house. Zachary was found 10 miles from home, and on his arrest he said, "I didn't feel anything when I killed her." Zachary's trial for the murder of his mother began, and when he was asked if he could go back in time, would he do it again? He smirked and said, "Yes, and I'd kill Josh with the sledgehammer too." Zachary showed absolutely zero remorse in the courtroom, but his defence argued that he'd been hearing his father's voice and had been told to kill his mother. His grandma also testified that he hadn't got the help that he needed as he was mentally ill, and he's not a monster, he's a child that made a terrible mistake. But after hearing from Zachary himself, the jury weren't so compassionate. He laughed when he described how heavy the murder weapon was and took joy in describing the sound it made when it hit his mother's head. He was asked why he'd hit her so many times, and his response was, "I wanted to make sure she was dead." The jury deliberated for just 3 hours before reaching a guilty verdict. Zachary was sentenced to life with a minimum of 51 years, meaning he'll be in his mid-60s when he's eligible for parole.
Imagine getting married only to be decapitated by your husband 3 months later. 21-year-old couple Jared and Angie got married in October 2022. Around 4 p.m. on the 11th of January, police were called to their home in Texas. Police made a grim discovery in the pair's bathroom after finding, quote, what appeared to be the head of the victim to be in the shower, end quote. Angie's body was discovered on the floor near the bed in a pool of blood with multiple stab wounds to her back. It was actually Jared's poor parents that initially made this discovery after entering the home. They then obviously alerted police to what they found. Jared was arrested and has confessed to killing his wife with a kitchen knife. Jared was actually captured on CCTV, casually stealing a bottle of beer from Angie's workplace just minutes after it's believed that he killed her. Angie's friends have reported to police that the couple's relationship was toxic and Jared was very controlling. Jared's bond is currently set at $500,000. This schoolboy stabbed his teacher to death in front of a classroom full of students. 61-year-old Anne Maguire was a Spanish teacher teaching in Leeds. She'd actually worked at the school for 40 years and she was only 5 months off retirement. However, in April 2014, something absolutely horrific happened. One of her students was 15-year-old Will Cornick. He'd always been described as a smart student who never really caused any trouble. Classmates regarded him as a polite student, but after he got diagnosed with diabetes, his personality seemed to change. In 2013, he tried to join the army, but because of his diagnosis, he was rejected. Being in the army had been his dream, so this was really upsetting for him. After failing to complete his Spanish homework, he was given detention by Anne. He also expressed a wish to her that he wanted to drop Spanish, but she wouldn't let him, which only angered him more. He began to develop a deep-rooted grudge against Anne. Shockingly, he reportedly messaged his friends on Facebook asking if one of them would kill her for him for £10. During one school day, halfway through his Spanish class, Will decided to get up and attack Anne with a knife. The classmates watched on in horror as he chased her out of the classroom. When there, another teacher heard her screams and tried to shield Anne from any more blows from him. Will then allegedly returned to his class and told his classmates how it was a shame that he hadn't killed her. However, Anne did actually pass away from her injuries. Will later admitted that he did plan also to kill two other teachers. One of them was actually pregnant at the time. He's been sentenced to life in prison with a minimum of 20 years. This is one of the most horrific cases I've heard recently, so please be warned before watching. 29-year-old Taylor Parker has just been sentenced to death for a crime so horrendous that I can't believe a human is capable of this. Regan Simmons Hancock and Taylor had met online. Their online friendship soon blossomed into a real-life connection. It was 2022 and Regan was married with a young daughter. She was also 8 months pregnant at this time. Taylor was also pregnant, or so it would seem to the outside world. She was posting pregnancy pictures on social media and even hosted a gender reveal party. Little did her loved ones know that she was actually staging the entire thing. Regan and Taylor were really good friends around this time and they were bonding over their pregnancies. Regan even shared a Facebook status thanking Taylor for bringing her around a gift and Starbucks. This was the day before she would be murdered by Taylor. On Taylor's supposed due date, she made her way round to Regan's house in Texas. Shortly after, Regan's mum made a horrifying discovery. Her daughter was face down on the floor, deceased, with blood everywhere. Her mum rang the emergency services and they raced to the scene. It became apparent that her baby had been, and again, a massive trigger warning here. ripped out of her stomach, and Regan had been stabbed over 100 times. Meanwhile, Taylor was pulled over for speeding and driving erratically. She'd actually put the baby in her lap with the umbilical cord coming out of her trousers to make it seem like she'd just given birth. When the pair were taken to hospital, the horrors of what actually happened became apparent. The newborn baby tragically passed away and Taylor was arrested. She was sentenced to death, but her defense lawyer said that her loved ones should have done more to protect her earlier on when she was pretending to be pregnant.